I'm really excited to be here, both with an amazing panel, but also the combination of having this conference run by the Open Education Consortium, an organization that I used to be on the board of and am a huge fan of, and having the event take place in Cape Town, which is where I used to live for 10 years and actually did a lot of my, got started with my open education work. So it's quite a, it's kind of an exciting time. It's an exciting place. And we're here to talk about kind of the last 10 years of open education, because 10 years ago, a group of 28 troublemakers, I guess, came together in Cape Town, organized by a small group of really innovative funders, the Shuttleworth Foundation, Open Society Foundations, Mozilla, and Hewlett got involved a little bit later as well, and kind of got together to talk a little bit about this thing called open education, and what were we excited about, and what did we make of it. And we had, you know, Jimmy Wales from Wikipedia was there, and Rich was there, and Delia was there, and you know, we drafted this declaration, the Cape Town Open Education Declaration, that's endured quite well, I think, over the years. And so 10 years later, we thought it would make sense to bring a similar group of people together to both look back at what we've learned over the last 10 years and also look forward to see what we're excited about for the next 10 years. So I want to tell you a little bit about the process, because it is an open process, and we invite all of you to get involved. But then we'll launch into essentially just a discussion amongst the panelists and all of you, hopefully. This is designed to be very interactive. We only have two mics, so that's a little bit of a logistical challenge. But I invite all of you to write notes or prepare questions or get involved in the discussion. So Cape Town Plus 10, in the lead up to this conference, we conducted a bunch of interviews, about 25 people, many of whom had been at the original meeting, many of whom had drafted the declaration, and about a third who hadn't, who were kind of new projects, new people in the community. And we identified 10 topics that we thought would be good conversation starters. And then we brought together 26 people on Wednesday afternoon. Many of you were there. And kind of dug into those themes and those topics to see, as a group, did we feel like there was more work to be done? Was there excitement in the room? And I mean, I think we all came away very very inspired and re-excited, and so we decided that it was worth putting more energy into this and thinking about how we could take the ideas of Cape Town forward over the next few months and years. And so we're planning to prepare an additional 10. We haven't decided the word yet. They could be points, they could be principles. An additional 10 points that serve as an addendum to the Cape Town Open Education Declaration. And those would be areas that we feel maybe have been missing, or where there's a particular opportunity for us to go into, or where we think the next 10 years are headed. What's happening when we come back together, as we will, in 10 years in Cape Town? What are the things we'll look back to then? And so this is one effort that's part of a larger group of efforts, and we're not trying to be competing with those other things. We're really hoping that the discussion coming out of this Cape Town group will be complementary specifically to the efforts of UNESCO, and Sanjay will talk about that, and Joe, actually, I think at the end, will talk about that a little bit. And so we think it's probably easier for a group like this to be a little more controversial or a little more radical and say the things that are hard to say if you have to agree with, you know, hundreds of member governments. But we are we're very excited about the UNESCO process, and we hope that the work coming out of this group will feed into that and be supportive. I think that's all I'll say. Well, so the sentence in the Cape Town declaration that kind of stands out for me from the first paragraph is that we wrote, "We are on the cusp of a revolution in teaching and learning." And it feels like that was true back then, and it still feels true today in some way, but maybe for other reasons. And so I want to open the panel by asking each of our four panelists to answer the same question and use the question also to introduce themselves. And that question is, if you all work in very different regions, topics, if you look back over the last 10 years, what is something that stands out for you? What's something that you have learned since the Cape Town Open Education Declaration? And we'll start with you, Sanjay.
Thank you, Philip, and hello, everybody. I'm Sanjay Mishra, Education Specialist e-learning at the Commonwealth of Learning. And I'm sure most of you know about the organization. We work with governments and educational institutions to promote OER and technology-mediated education, teaching and learning, largely in the broader spectrum of open education. We help institutions and government to develop policies, build capacities, create content, and foster collaboration in line with promoting education for sustainable development. So I myself have been in the Commonwealth of Learning for last 5 years in different capacities. But some of my views are going to be very personal as a disclaimer. It may not be necessarily that of my organization. If you look back, the open Cape Town Declaration, Open Education Declaration, I think we have progressed a lot. And in fact, on Wednesday, when I had a meeting, I talked about that there are a lot of positives to look at, but it also brings a lot of challenges because of new things that has happened over the years in the last 10 years. Just to highlight a few things, I would talk about how some of the key things that the declaration talked about in terms of policies. In terms of OER policies, you will see that there is some increase in OER policies at national level and mostly in institutional level. The policies at institutional level are increasing in rapid speed in that sense. But awareness of OER is not up to speed in that extent. More so because of turnover in educational institutions that happen, and there are large number of educational institutions if you look at a global scale. And from a Commonwealth perspective, I see that itself as a challenge working in 52 countries. We also see the kind of barriers to OER, why it is not happening are quite different in different regions. At some point, it's access to technology and infrastructure. At other place, it's not having an appropriate business model or more copyright concern or quality as a matter of concern. And different types of things are inhibiting that progress. And those are the challenges we actually need to look at. Overall, I think that it's a milestone and we are all inspired. I was not there, but I have been inspired by this whole process. As an educational institution at CAHL, I think we have been in the process of open education on OER well before the term OER was created. And in fact, the first sharing of content that was developed and shared without an open license was in the African region, and it started in Africa for teacher education at primary level, and several institutions from Africa actually contributed to those processes. So it's a long way to go. We have last number of content has increased dramatically. We have lot many repositories, but the usage is quite different. We have recent studies. We look at the awareness about repositories are very little in educational institutions. So it's a mixed feeling for me to look. A look back with some sort of happiness that a declaration that happened here has resulted into some different kinds of momentum. But at the same time, it brings a lot of challenges for all of us, not just for my organization or myself as a person. I have myself have been in the field since 2006. So I see that there is a lot for me, myself, to do, and all of us collectively to do.
Great. We'll just go along. But so, Delia, what is something over the last 10 years fighting for open that you have learned?
Okay, to just introduce myself, my name's Delia Brown, and I'm from Sydney, Australia, and I'm the National Copyright Director for the school sector and the technical further education colleges sector in Australia. So basically, I work with a team providing copyright advice to all the schools in Australia and all the TAFEs in Australia. So I don't look after universities, they're the only ones I don't look after. So a core part of what I do, obviously, because copyright is complex, and teachers are the biggest users of other people's material in the world, is coming up with strategies to help empower teachers to do what they want to do in the classroom, and to work ways around dealing with the obstacles that copyright presents when teachers are using particularly things like the internet or YouTube or new technologies or things like that. And another part of my role is also really being a very strong advocate for copyright law reform. So one of the things that I've learned over the last 10 years is the things that I do for OER are the same things I do for copyright law reform. There are so many synergies between what we're trying to achieve, which actually is building a public domain, and enabling remixing, sharing, and retention of resources. And those same values are the same values you have with you were doing with copyright law reform, and you're dealing with OER or open policies or Creative Commons. And so there's a lot of synergies there that we need to kind of explore in the future. That's one thing I've learned. The second thing I've learned, we're going to be talking about policy in this panel, is it's about also giving people tools to actually do OER. Like a lot of time when I would talk to teachers, they go, this sounds great, you know, CC licenses sound great, OER sounds great, but they don't know how to get engaged or get started or where to find things or how to license things. So one of the things that we've been focusing on in the last 2 or 3 years is making it easy for teachers and curriculum developers, e-learning developers within the departments of education and the K-12 school sector, the non-gov school sector, is to give them those tools that they can actually start doing it, the implementation stuff. Because it's all very well having policies, but unless you can show people how to do stuff, it's a real hurdle. So we spend a lot of time trying to sort of develop using other people's good toolkits and trying to improve them from a teacher perspective. We get loads of feedback from teachers about what's not working, what's working. I'm a lawyer. Sometimes I think I'm very clear, but often I may not be. So it's very important getting the feedback. So I think that the implementation stuff is something we really need to work on. But there's lots of, you know, but there's so much stuff that's been happening the last 10 years, at least, that people now know what OER, they recognize what it means, but how do we get them to kind of keep doing it?
Keep going, Rich.
Oh. Hi, everybody. I'm Rich Baranek from Rice University and OpenStax. Just thank the conference organizers for the chance to be up here today and be in beautiful Cape Town. I've learned a lot from the discussions with many of you.
As Rich starts speaking, the lights go up. I wonder if there's a...
That's because I'm kind of dim. I'm kind of dim, so the lights aren't. So it's fun to think back over these last 10 years because I've been working in this space for almost 20 years. So ever since founding Connections in 1999, any Connections fans? No, Hal's a Connections fan. So... which was a platform, right? A platform to develop and share what became known as open educational resources. But I think that I've learned a tremendous amount since the Cape Town Declaration 10 years ago, because after 13 years as a platform, we realized that wasn't enough. It wasn't enough to just facilitate open education. We also had to create open education. And so we became a publisher, and it was a big shift. It was a big pivot for us, basically pledging that we were going to build a library of free and open textbooks, complete turnkey solutions for all of the big intro level textbooks. This is completely USA centric at this point. And then make them free and open in Connections, right? CC BY licensed. So we've made a lot of progress on this over the last 5 years. We're literally 5.5 years since we launched the publishing side of the organization. We've published our 27th textbook recently. We're in 38% of all U.S. degree-granting institutions, so 38% of all colleges, universities are using at least one of our books. And this school year, 1 million U.S. students in college are using at least one of our books, and they've saved $100 million. Right? So and I'll talk more about that, about free versus open, right, and attention around that. The last thing that we have been really excited about is that companies are actually very interested in partnering with us. Much like the Red Hat Lennox symbiotic relationship, we have 47 companies, including all the big publishers except one, you can guess who are working with us to add value-added services around our free and open books, and then revenue sharing so we can be sustainable long-term. So that's where we are. And I'd just like to make a few points of perspective of what I've learned over the last 10 years. And again, this is completely from a U.S. and a college perspective. And one of the things that happened at the meeting that Philip talked about earlier was there was a poster on the wall that said, "Open textbooks are winning the war." And so I'm gonna dispute that, and I'm going to disagree very strongly with that, because I think we, even though there's been tremendous progress, there is so much that we need to do over the next 10 years in order to truly win this war. And I think some of the points were already brought up, so I'll be really quick. First, at least in the United States, is lack of awareness. There's just a tremendous lack of awareness. There was a survey by Babson College. They do a survey every several years. Of U.S. college faculty, 60% were completely unaware of what open educational resources were, okay? Only 25% were aware. So we're still very, very far away from folks being aware. And we need, as a community, including the governments, policymakers, foundations, we need to find ways to get the word out more about open education and incentivize, in some cases, faculty and schools to adopt these kind of ideas. The second that I think is once people are aware, then they go to try to adopt something, and then they realize that there's a lack of coverage. There's a lot of OER out there, but there aren't enough turnkey solutions in the courses that faculty really would like to use OER in. And that's precisely why we got into the publishing business 5 years ago. And then the last, a bit more controversially, I think that there's also there's just a very broad spectrum of quality and finishedness of the content that, again, makes it very hard for folks to adopt curriculum. And I think one South African, or just one shining example that happens to be based out of Cape Town is the Siavula Project. Any Siavula fans? Okay, so they've just done a fantastic job in thinking about how to bring faculty together into teams, train them to generate really generate really high quality content and peer review it amongst themselves. And so I'm just really excited about projects like that moving forward.
Great, thanks, Rich. Alec.
Hello, my name is Alec Tarkowski. I come from Poland, and I am a godson of the Cape Town Declaration in terms of being an open education advocate. Before that, I think I was more of a general Creative Commons person. I have been doing Creative Commons Poland much earlier. And I think in Poland, the declaration really triggered a lot of things. Of course, it's never just one factor, but really a lot of good things came together. And I want to also acknowledge the work done by Jarosław Lipschitz, who was here the first time. So he sort of passed the invisible, what do you call it?
Baton.
And we continue to work together. And the reason we do it is because we have a coalition. And I wanted to speak about that, because I think coalitions are really nice things. We have one in Europe, we have in Poland, we have in Europe, I think around 7 or 8 of them in different countries. They're sometimes called coalitions, they're sometimes called alliances, they're sometimes informal, but some idea that people should get together. And now, what do they do together? I think this is also interesting, because we do two things. On one side, the coalition supports policy work. But on the other, it's a community. And I think the fact that it's connected, so we always keep policy in mind, even if some of our members are not very policy oriented, you know, they keep this engagement, they keep this interest. But also we try to make it as a community. It's a community that's pretty broad in terms of stretching interest in OE and OER. We have one of National Galleries. We have one of the library associations. We have Polish Wikipedians, you know, a pretty broad group, which makes me very happy. And the reason I mention is that a lot of the discussion around Cape Town is about policy, and I think this coalition has been fundamental in securing the policies we have in Poland. Of course, the role of the government was also very important. It's another story where it's hard to say that there was just like one actor who did it, but I'm pretty certain that if we didn't have a coalition, we wouldn't have made it so visible as a stake to the government. So what are the lessons that come out of this? I wish these coalitions would scale and that we find it's a lot harder to do beyond national level. It'd be lovely to have a European coalition, which serve the same functions. I think, and especially international, of course, the challenge is how to define the stakes. I think UNESCO, in a way, by doing the process that's very collaborative, builds a kind of similar community. That's one point. The other point I want to make is that maybe we'll talk more about how policies work. They're successful, but then you face things like, for instance, government change, and you ask yourself, are they going to survive? You know, maybe they'll survive on paper, but not in reality. We had a government change a year and a half ago in Poland, and it seems one of the key factors in keeping things going was the fact that there were certain people with whom we built relationships, because we are working on a coalition, we are working on the community, and suddenly they land in different positions in the government, you know, including political advisors to the minister or the crucial minister. So it's for me a story how communities and policies intertwine over the last 10 years.
Great, thank you. So I think that's a great kind of foundation to start off from. And I'll ask a few questions to the panel. You guys feel free to engage with each other, disagree, you know, let's see. Let's not get physical, but I think it's perfectly okay to have different opinions. But then I also would encourage you, if you want to ask a question or make a comment, maybe you could come to the front here, because we only have the two mics, and then I'll essentially let you use my mic if you want to participate. But yeah, or if you actually, that's not a bad idea. If you want to ask a question, then you're going to have to come up here and ask it to the audience. Well, there are a couple of things I definitely want to get to, but maybe we build on this this question of coalition and the role of policy, because one of the topics at the workshop on Wednesday, someone at the end said, Mark Horner, who runs Siavula, that was mentioned a second ago, said that in his work, he feels like he's always felt like if only there was a policy, if only there was a stronger policy, and he's come to the realization that actually he's fine without having a policy. And so he had this puzzled look, and he was like, and actually I realized I don't need a policy. And in my work, I don't really work in policy. I'm very happy other people do it, but it's such a hard, slow process. So I want to hear kind of, you know, some of you work more in policy than others, but what do you think is the right role? How should we be thinking about policies? At what level? And what have you learned about, you know, both creating policies that are effective, but then also not stopping at the policy and kind of building coalitions around it?
Policy can be helpful, but to a certain extent, perhaps I do agree with Mark that they're not always essential. So in Australia, for instance, we haven't got an official open education policy, but there's a number of policies to do with innovation and education revolution, digital education revolution, the Australian Open Government licensing framework, and there might be policies that the government has in relation to STEM education or distance learning. And so what you can do is you can actually go to those policies and say, in order to achieve this, OER is going to be an essential component for success and a key performance indicator. So how we managed to get all the departments of education in Australia, there's 7 states and territory departments of education in Australia, to license their websites CC BY, and to agree in principle to license any education resources that the departments themselves develop or get funding for to be released under CC BY. That's simply because I said the government, each state government has endorsed the Australian Government Open Licensing Framework. We are not in compliance. We need to be in compliance. The second thing I said to the departments of education was, one of the things you want me to do and my team to do is help kind of manage copyright compliance costs because Australia has a compulsory education license system set out in mind-numbingly detail over 25 pages of the Copyright Act, which five lawyers understand, of which I am one of them, which costs the schools around $100 million a year in collective license managing fees, and each year the schools spend approximately at least $700 million a year buying new content, purchasing educational content. Remember, this is Australia. That's 3.5 million school children. That's 10,000 schools. That's a lot of money that we're spending every year buying content and also paying additional license fees for it. So they would say to me, we want, you to go and get sort of more government departments to, be endorsing Ausgoal and because the stuff we're paying for is like tourism maps and, government material. I said, well, we can't do that unless we are the best practices. I said, you want me to go and talk to the Attorney General's Department or the Department of Environmental and Planning and the Heritage Department and saying, you guys need to be releasing your stuff under CC BY. And I say, well, we're not doing it. So sometimes it's actually leveraging on the policies of the particular government at the time and just saying to them, OER is actually going to be a core component for you to reach success. This already exists, it's easy to do, rather than coming up with a national kind of OER policy. Now, in other countries, that might be completely different. Other countries have been very clever in using the Open Government Partnership Agreement, which most countries have signed up to. And so in their national action plans, they've actually put OER as one of the action items for the next 2 years. And you've seen countries, I think, like Estonia do it. I mean, US has done it in its US Go Open. I think there's maybe 20 countries have adopted OER in the Open Government Action Plan. There's another way just to get it into whatever the policies are. So I think they can be useful. But I think Mark's kind of really right. You don't wait around for the perfect policy to kind of turn up. You kind of jump on anything that's kind of popular with the government at the time and just wedge OER into it is the way that you would do it.
I think my take is like this, that if you have, if you can work on OER without a policy, that's good. And most of the time, experience in the developing countries says that the problem with the teachers, if you ask them why you are not doing enough, even if you know OER, first problem is they don't know about OER. But you educate them, you do a capacity building, you tell them about OER, the first thing the impediments they talk about is we don't have a policy. Either an institutional policy or a national government policy. So that becomes something that needs to work a lot. And in fact, my own research, which I did with the support of IDRC and under the ROER for D, in India, this became one of the important things that we don't have policies to work on OER. So there is lack of understanding of copyright and lack of understanding of licenses, but they are talking about we need some policy at an institutional level, at a national level, to government to come out. So that's the kind of need in, I work in Bangladesh, Malaysia, in Caribbean countries, in Belize, and so on St. Lucia, and I find the same kind of things in many Commonwealth countries, they talk about this. So we are engaged in this process so that policy, we say that's one of the three pillars to make OER success. You build capacities, you build appropriate policies, and you support appropriate technologies to foster OER. So you fill in that gap. So one of the pillars to make OER successful is to create enabling environment. The other challenge on policy is that, what is a policy? What is this beast policy is all about? And that's where the problem is. Most people don't understand what is being talked about when it is a policy. And is it a guideline? Is it something, a strategy paper in the government? Or is it something about open licensing policy as such? So that understanding is completely missing. And there are different types of policies. So there is a commitment of the government in the strategy paper and in one of the countries, I'm not going to name specifically, but when I tell, we consider that, okay, that is a policy, then say the officials in the country, no, we don't have a policy. Then I said, look, your document talks about this statement and objective one as promoting open educational resources is one of your country's objective in their strategic plan. Oh no, that's a commitment. So it's an understanding about those processes and what do you then want to do it? They said, no, we want to detail it out how to do it. So it becomes a guide. Okay. So it's a whole understanding of the OER policy itself. What constitutes a policy of OER policy? Some people even are going to extend up talking about open education policy. Okay, and then you talk about open education policy, it becomes another ball game. So I'll come to later, which is very important for me to talk about sometime later. I get an opportunity, but in policy, this might take.
By the way, a quick test. The Cape Town Declaration on A, open education, or B, open educational resources? A, hands up. Cape Town Declaration on Open Education, what's the title?
What's it called?
Yeah. Open education, hands up. Open educational resources, hands up. And a lot of people don't want to take part in the quiz because this is not school. Yes, the majority wins. But I'm asking this because I have to admit that since I haven't read the declaration for a while and now I refreshed it in my mind, it kind of switched into an open educational resources or licensing declaration. And I'm happy to admit it because I hope some of you share this. Feeling, and it's I think
one person in the back.
Yes, thank you. It's very symptomatic. I think, at least for a lot of work I see doing, I think we limit the work to very specific also policies. So not just policies, but licensing issues. We for sure in Poland for a very long time our strategy was, let's achieve openly licensed textbooks. And I'm not here to. Be ashamed of that because you have to bet on something. It's a very good bet, but once you get there, you have to think about other things. And by the way, I want to say, I mean, I think though it's kind of good for this like practical talk to understand what works with talking about policies and what doesn't. I don't think it's at all really important personally, and then I don't want to offend any of you, but I think maybe it would be better to call it politics because this is kind of what it is. Once in a while doing policy feels exciting. I kind of envy, I was involved a bit in it, but Nicole Allen, who's here, worked with Jan Gondol on Slovakian OGP policy to include educational commitments there, and watching it on from the side and helping a bit, it felt like a rush, basically, like a great thing. But that's rare. A lot of the time, you know, you're right. We write these documents and add these sentences there so that bureaucrats can look at them and say like, oh yeah, and then change some budgeting. It's you know, it's not that great, but it's important because it changes the system. And in the end, of course, it's like chicken egg. It's more important that the individual teacher with the power to do something or the system that she's in. Probably it's both. And I just last point I want to make. There's one problem with policy. Once you enforce, for instance, licensing by a policy, it's no longer a personal choice of that teacher to think about it, that he's doing something for things to work differently. It's just a rule that's enforced at different steps of the administration, and that's the big risk we run, that it's going to get very automatic and not an individual choice.
The thing that worked with the Australian Government Open Access License Framework is that it was basically a rule that said the default license that must be applied to any publicly funded informational data must be a CC BY license unless there's a really good business case for it not to be. For instance, obviously, defence secrets would be, anything being publicly disseminated would be. So having that kind of rule there, which was endorsed by all the state and territory department governments, means that you can point to that and say, well, you're not in compliance because it's actually a rule. It's a very simple thing. Now, that's not actually an OER policy, but that rule, pointing to that really, really helps. The other thing to do with policy really is to get government institutions and agencies to start doing things in a more open way. I don't think an open education policy is going to be filtered down so much to a teacher level, because you can't make teachers only use OER. You can encourage them, you can show them the benefits of it, but I see what teachers use in the classroom on a daily basis because of the terrible copyright surveys that a certain number of schools have to do every year, and they use all sorts of stuff. They use YouTube, they use little bits from newspapers, they use like photographs from shopping catalogues, they use a whole range of things. A lot of teachers, particularly in Australia, and I think also in South Africa, they actually create their own learning resources using a whole variety of materials. So policy is really good for getting government to do things. The other thing that's really important in government is government wastes money in education to a certain extent. There's been this practice for decades in Australia, and I suspect in other countries as well, where the government decides they want to produce some resources for education. Say it's for indigenous language, for Eastern European languages or Asian languages, or now it's all about STEM. STEM's the new kind of buzzword for governments around the world. We need to have more STEM resources. So they get a whole lot of taxpayers' money. They engage a publisher or something similar to a publisher to produce those resources. They give that publisher the copyright for those resources. We've paid them to do it, and now they're selling that stuff back to us. Selling it back to us and getting license fees. So that's kind of a crazy thing that our governments around the world are actually doing. And going, no, if we are creating resources that are filling in the gap, or which is not being met by other educational resource providers and publishers, then the requirement should be if we're commissioning them to do it. If you want, they must release it under a CC BY license. If they want to value add to that and sell it back to us, fine. But basically, stop paying people with taxpayers. Stop making taxpayers pay twice. Just kind of stop. It's a waste of absolute money. So that's why those sort of things in policy are very useful. But on the day-to-day basis for a teacher, really, they just want to do what they want to do and not be disturbed and think too much about copyright.
Did you want to get in on this, Rich?
I'll just say briefly that I totally agree with everything you're saying. There are also cases, though, where policy, I think this was alluded to, but can create more friction than was there in the first case. And the example that we've come up against are mandates to use OER, mandates that faculty or instructors should use OER. And at least in the United States, this completely goes against academic freedom. And we have found that is the quickest way to ensure that an OER initiative fails is to actually mandate that it be used.
So, an example, I haven't seen that.
You haven't seen it?
No, we always say don't mandate.
I don't think I can name the schools in a public forum.
You can come up with fictional names.
Oh, fictional names? East Oaxaca Community College.
That was our first contribution from the floor, by the way. So I do. There is an open invitation. I'll ask one more question, Sophie, then we'll come to you. So I do want to broaden the conversation a little bit, because to Alex's point, that when he reflected back on the declaration, I think it is true that for a lot of people, the declaration and also a lot of the work that has happened has really focused on content and OER. And when we wrote the declaration, we actually talked about three things. We talked about content, about practice and pedagogy, and about recognition and accreditation. And arguably, we haven't really made as much progress on those other two points as we have on the first one. And maybe even more intriguing is that I think the world has made tremendous progress on those points. So I think if we talk about digital education or digital enabled education, we have seen incredible changes and innovation in how people are learning and teaching, so pedagogy and practice. And I think we are starting to see incredible examples of new types of recognition and accreditation. I know TU Delft is here, but the MicroMasters, for example. But those, and in the case of TU Delft, they come out of an open tradition, But all the other institutions that are doing those things actually are not part of the open movement. They don't use open content. So there's so much innovation coming out of this more traditional, or what we thought of the more traditional space. And then lastly, I am completely amazed by YouTube. So YouTube is a closed educational resource. It's controlled by one company. I'm saddened by those things. But it is an amazing learning community. You can learn almost anything on YouTube. And you can see in the comments there where people are asking questions and leaving answers for each other that there is sharing going on. So YouTube kind of isn't on our radar, I think. Or maybe it was off the radar as a closed thing and we are focused on the open thing. But the world is changing in such interesting ways that I think my challenge to all of us is we need a way to think about things like YouTube and maybe make them more open, or maybe have an alternative that's open. But so I guess that was a long rambling statement rather than a question. But so if we're thinking more like beyond content, the revolution that's happening there, like where do you see both challenges for the open movement, but also where do you see places there where we should be moving into and doing more?
I think I was tempted to talk about this, particularly from a perspective of open education. And I'm personally more aligned towards the subtext of the Cape Town Declaration. The subtext is about OER. There are other ramblings that was there in that Cape Town Declaration, but to me, I was not there. But what was important at that time was lack of content. Lack of content, lack of rights to reuse and remix. And that was important at that time. The other things were probably, you know, somebody talks about critical discourse yesterday and today. So I think I use that and talk about that. If you look at that, to me, or most people, of course not here, was about OER. And what I see is here that the OER movement is trying to reinvent open education to a large extent now. And that's what, to me, is a sad thing to happen. It's important to recognize that open education didn't got invented in 2007. It got a boost in 2007 because of the declaration. And then a lot of new things has happened because of technological developments that has happened. Open education is all about the freedoms that is given to students or learners. Open education is all about choices of courses, curriculum, place and time, not limited to the synchronicity of teaching and learning that happens in our classroom. Given that thing, open education allows us to make a better teaching and learning environment for sustainable development goals as well. But what is important for us is that in the overall picture, open education is a continuum. None of our educational institutions are either completely open or completely closed. And you will never have a completely open institution in any organization, because one of the primary requirement in open education is open entry, which none of the educational institutions provide to a large extent, except some of the open universities of the world. So it's important to recognize this open education and place the requirement, OER, where does it fit in? And I'll quote here David Wiley's constant emphasis of remix and reuse. And that's creating new educational practices that brings new vibrancy into the classroom system. And that's only possible because of one of the key development on doing things legally, because of better understanding of copyrights facilitated by a widely accepted practice like Creative Commons. There are other ways of doing things than Creative Commons. Creative Commons is getting more popular, but people do different things in different ways to share. Okay. So they can just write it about how to use without using a logo of Creative Commons. So for me as an individual, I see it's about it's not just about content per se. Content changing the other things happen. Because without that content, open universities have been doing a lot of things contents. It was only probably new for the conventional universities because they were more dependent on textbooks per se. So it's important to recognize that it's the OER movement, its content is still needed. Only with the content we will build other services. That's currently happening with RISE, it's university stacks, Lumen. There are other models where service is getting into practice so that you have better learning analytics, you can help learners better, make the teaching and learning process more transparent, open. Of course, privacy issues and other things that is attached. But I think this is what I would like all of you to think about. Do you want the whole OER movement to be bigger enough and diluted if that goes in that direction? Or it's important for us to think about open education as only OER? So it's a critical moment for us. I'm not telling that other things are not important. Open pedagogy is important, but it has been there. In educational literature, it is told in different names. Some people will take learning theories, some people will say constructivist theories, and so on and so forth. So I had a discussion some time back with Rory. He said, in OERU, we are not interested in this pedagogy thing because somebody will say pedagogy, somebody will say andragogy, somebody will say deterministic learning, heutagogy. So that's completely different thing. So a little different than what everyone is thinking, but this is my humble submission.
Just trying to remember, but at the time, I'll just make another little confession here, which I forgot to say, but I'm also one of the Creative Commons affiliates in Australia. I'm the education lead and also a co-founder with Philip and on the board of Peer-to-Peer University. And interesting about YouTube is like really massively used by teachers in Australia. And when we were doing the Cape Town Declaration back 2007, a lot of the focus of the people in the room probably was the cost of textbooks. That kind of wasn't my focus at the time. My focus at the time was really about, you know, looking at OER as a cost management tool for copyright license fees to a certain extent, and also an early recognition at that stage just basically that how the internet was really changing things with the teachers in schools. And one of the things we still haven't quite won yet is the idea that things on the internet are, they're free, but they're not necessarily open or legal for you to use, and copyright is incredibly complex. When I sometimes talk about copyright to teachers and workshops, etc., I say we haven't actually had the iPad that long, or the use of now mobile phones and smart tablets. In Australia, you have bring your own devices, which is a very common thing in schools. The fact that, you know, I actively encourage schools and teachers to share things on YouTube rather than iTunes U, because on YouTube you can actually apply a CC license to it, and on YouTube you can actually search for it. I've had conversations with Apple saying, you guys got to get jiggy with it, because it's really difficult. I said, I can just recommend that we use YouTube, you know. You look at the impact of the Google Chromebooks now being used in classrooms, etc., Google Classroom. So at the moment, all I'm doing now is thinking about information sheets about how do I tell teachers how to do 3D printing? Because there's copyright issues to do with that. How can I encourage them when they do 3D printing or finding projects to do that they choose CC license 3D projects so they're actually complying with copyright issues? So I've been thinking about artificial intelligence right now, you know, because I have to think now, because teachers are the earliest adopters of new technologies. The second largest group, the first group actually is pornographers, and then it's teachers for new technology. That's why I don't like the word pedagogy. It suggests other things. But I'm being naughty. He's stopping me, right? No. But the point being is, like, it happens so incredibly quickly. So it's important to have the principles rather than focusing on what we see right now.
So the P is for principles.
Principles, yeah, peers for principles. I suppose the point I'm sort of saying, even though that it might be YouTube or it might be iTunes Us or it might be Google Classroom, it used to be all about Moodle. I think Moodle is now being taken over more by, I think that's kind of on the way out. And I just think, you know, we have to be very aware that the technology is harnessed very quickly by teachers. And our biggest problem is that they think everything on the internet is free. So when I think that's what we've got to sort of like really break that nexus to. They think, oh, it's up there for free, therefore I can use it, rather than the openly licensed stuff.
Mm-hmm. Well, me or the question?
Yes. Thank you. For me, it's a very practical question to this wonderful community. You know, from the Cape Town Declaration, we had a lot of events, lot of declaration, like Paris Declaration, I never pronounce the good word, Quiqueon Declaration. We had a lot of events, we have a lot of people, we have lots of wonderful things, but can we imagine a better way, a smarter way, a simpler way to work together? You imagine 10 years ago, I was in this, I discovered the Open Education Consortium. We never met. We met some with Alec, but together we never met. So how can we, with all the organization working together in a more good way? So please. Give us some ideas for the OE consortium. Tomorrow we will have the board of when we will all traveling. We will have the board for the directors of the consortium. So we really need you, and that's just the good moment. Here or here. What advice?
I can say two things, but this will not be advice. One thing, I wouldn't worry extensively about coordinations. You know, movements in the end are movements. We are not a corporation. There are a lot of parts. Some of us like some word and others other. And I think that's fine. And adding to it and making, I think, the answer even less satisfactory for you. For instance, for me, for the last 2 years, it became really important to think about open education in the context of digital education more broadly. And I started appreciating something I didn't really like in the UNESCO Declaration. UNESCO Declaration has this part where it starts talking about access to basic infrastructure. You know, like you need broadband. And I was like, this is, at that time, I was like really into open licensing. I was like, let's not dilute it. This is supposed to be about open licensing of content, you know, and now I really appreciate it. And I would say one of the factors limiting open education, for instance, in Poland is lack of good broadband. We're trying to change it until 2020. What I mainly want to say that, for instance, I think we should be talking a lot more with these people. And the challenge, of course, there is if we don't use the word open, we won't get our message. And if we use it, they might run away a bit, maybe, or like fall asleep, or yes. That's completely probably wrong answer to your question.
but the other thing, it's when we're talking about OER, and I deal with organisations that are NGOs that are producing education materials that they want us to use. And so it's about getting them, you know, they're not going to be necessarily a part of the movement, but they'll appreciate, oh, this is an easy way for me to ensure stuff that's being done. The other thing I think is there's many different groups within the movement who are interested in doing particular things. We all have different focuses and passions about urban education, and sometimes the better way of doing that is actually finding those people who are doing similar stuff with you and to kind of move forward and to share. Like, for instance, obviously I'm, you know, some people are more into the policies, some more into the pedagogy and practice, some more into the practical, practical implementation stuff. Other people are maybe into kind of a little bit of the other sort of stuff that we're doing, like access. So it's a huge movement. But I think what our biggest challenge is actually making, it's going outside of who we are here, which are mainly people from education, into the more informal areas of the world. But anywhere that there is any organisation, any company that actually is doing anything that they want to education-wise, whether it's adult, children, citizens, whatever, to get that mindset about it.
Yeah, and actually, I think Alex's opening statement was a great answer to your question that you asked about building coalitions and finding topics that a number of organizations really care about, and maybe the national context is the right framing. Maybe doing some things internationally is harder, and then other things work internationally because people are interested in similar things. And my own experience has been it's always easiest to build a movement when people have something that they can do together. So if it's just about talking or even just declarations, I think it's not really going to get you somewhere. You know, and finding things that we can do together. And I think one of the nice things about this Cape Town Plus 10 with these 10 possible ideas or points is that those could be the kinds of things that are more where you do something together, you know. And so identifying those areas where people are really energized and they do want to work together, maybe some of it is international, maybe some of it is national, I think will be good. And then last point is, when we started with this open education movement, I always felt like it was a t-shirt. So you would, like, it was your primary, you would put on the t-shirt, right? Like, I'm an open education person. And now it feels more like it's a hashtag, where all of you wear different t-shirts, but there's kind of this hashtag that we can all use, open education or open learning or open, but it's okay that we all have our own identities. And I think that can make a movement very strong if you still manage to somehow connect to the principles that we all believe in. So it's like an interesting moment for us. I feel like we're much more messy and diverse, but maybe that's a good thing. Please, okay, two more. Oh, three more, and I knock over my glass. So we'll do Jöran, Gino, and then we had, who was over there? Someone, and then.
Thank you. It's Jöran, I have no real job title, I'm from Germany and into OER. So it's messy, like Philip said. I don't know. We can switch. No, not your job as a host, your job at Cambridge, the office. I want your office. So, okay. I wanted to say was, it was the question about what to do. I have the feeling in 2017, it doesn't feel too revolutionary. So I would be interested in other people's ideas where to look for the revolutionaries. So probably they are not organized in a consortium, because the consortium of revolutionaries is a contradiction in itself, probably. So my aim for 2017 personally, and maybe it's interesting to other people too, is to look for where is the revolution now? Is it the YouTubers, for example? Where to look for them and what to learn from them, and maybe to join forces with them. And maybe you have some ideas where to look.
Hi, thank you. So Sophie's question about like how can people start getting together? Oh, hi, I'm Gino Fransman, Nelson Mandela Metropolitan University, South Africa. So, Sophie's question about how can we start looking beyond the individuals who are doing these things. And Nicole Allen and Jan Gondel and their work in the OGP. So last year I was fortunate enough to speak on behalf of, well, Africa at the OGP Regional Summit. And what I realized there is that because it's a combination of civil society and government. And civil society there, these are big organizations, these are actors, these are the revolutionaries that you're looking for. So if we are going to start making inroads, those inroads do need to be somehow connected to policy development. And here's the big shocker. So I'm speaking about open education and the potential it has for Africa. From a South African perspective, and there's members of parliament, there's members of other governments from around the continent, and the fundamental gap there was that they didn't understand what open meant. So when we've got policymakers, when we've got these decision makers, there's a big call, and I know that in the GOGN we are a research group, right? So advocacy is sort of a bad word for us. But that's a big deal still. And I think that everyone's rushing to do something amazing and something impactful, but people just don't understand what we're doing.
Okay. No, I just wanted to say it's a jungle. Open.
It's a jungle. Okay. Yeah, I'm Christian Stracker from the Open University of the Netherlands, and yeah, it is a jungle, but we have not to reduce this jungle, but what we have to achieve is to be much more visible and to do much more marketing, and I think that was already stressed 2 days ago, and that's why I also do not like the main focus on OER, because open education is much more than OER, even so that we need OER. And there is also a reason why OER is always so prominent, because this is a label at least some people have heard of before. Sophie, one recommendation maybe to also connect, to build such coalitions and so on, and that's also connecting to your emphasis on activity. What we could consider is that we are not only sharing all our wonderful work that we are doing every year and bringing together and talking about that, but having also one day, one full day on one of these, we can select maybe one of the 10 points that you are now selecting and do something on that. As I have heard about, for example, the OER world map. It would be fantastic to have an edition, an OEP, an open practice, or what have you now agreed, principles, open education practices map. Just to sit together, all of us, in one day, we can have a wonderful, full map of all practices worldwide. Yeah? And that would be something that is then visible and sustainable after our conference here. And my recommendation is simply have one more day, and not only here at the OEC, but as well as in other conferences. And I will do that with our own conference. I decided just 5 minutes ago, we will do that at the World Learning Summit in Norway.
When is it?
Beginning of June.
Hi there, it's Rob Farrow from the Open University in the UK. I actually don't have a question. I just wanted to respond to the previous comment. You can already use the OER World Map for exactly that. So there's no need to build a new system, but the human side of the system could be improved. And that is about organization and coordination, and you're absolutely right to draw attention to that.
Wait. Just a quick question that came in from Twitter for Rich. People were interested in the idea that 38% of institutions have adopted an OpenStax textbook. Question is if you know how many of those adoptions roughly are out of the box, off the shelf, versus adoptions?
Good question. So I mentioned that we're developing these open textbooks. But they look like a publisher textbook, but they're also still living inside this Connections digital repository. So they are malleable and flexible. And I'll just give you this. I don't know percentage-wise how many of the adoptions are the canonical book versus the a repurposed book or an edited book. But I do know that there are 200 different versions of our biology text. There are 100 different versions of our physics text, and some of these are developed by individual faculty and also by institutions. And so I think it just sort of proves the point that faculty are, they're very busy and they would prefer to adopt first and then adapt second. So, but I could look for those stats. It's a good question.
Hi, I'm Jenny Heyman, one of the very proud members of the GoGN Network and working on research in open educational practices. My research is focused on the learners and learner empowerment. So I think the answer to the question about where is the revolution, it's with the learners, absolutely. We, in movements and in organizations, we often take the paternalistic view of the poor learners, here's what they need, here's what we can do for them. We need to hear from them, we need to empower them if we feel that they're the ones who have the greatest benefit for what we're trying to do, we need them in our spaces, on our side. We need to hear their voices. My challenge for this conference for next year is to have at least 50% attendance from actual learners in the world who want to talk about this. Just think of this group and all of us, how many learners we come into contact with. Just one person to 500 learners, one person to 10,000 learners. Where do you think the power is? It's not with me, it's with those 10,000 learners.
Yes, I totally agree with you. And thank you for making that point. And we kind of, there's always someone who makes that point at this conference or these conferences, and then it never actually happens. And I don't know why. And maybe 50% is a little... all right, here's the challenge to this also, is where are the learners really? Because if I look at what's happening inside the universities, we are doing everything to, we're creating a system where the learners that I encounter often ask, is that going to be on the test? Is that going to be on the exam? The learners are so prepared on winning at the game of university because we have created these systems of assessments, of management, of pushing people through, that we're actually not giving them the space to be learners in the university. So what I'm more interested in is, where are these learners really hanging out and doing the things that they want to do, maybe after they graduate? And so thinking of learners as people at all ages, even before university and long after universities, that are learning with each other openly, like, where are they? I would love to see more of those people here. And I think there, someone told me a story the other day, and I haven't confirmed this, so it could be totally wrong, but it's a great story anyway. That there's a javelin, that's the thing where you throw the stick, right? That there is a Kenyan javelin athlete who learned javelin from YouTube and then won an Olympic medal or something. So, okay, so I want to go to the conference where we have a panel of people who learned how to win Olympic gold medals from YouTube and hear what their strategies were and, like, how did they get into this. And so I think... yes, and yeah, maybe.
So can I share a practical idea in terms of getting the learners? And I just remembered, I have a practical answer for you. In Poland, a group of teachers called Superbelwszy, the super teachers, made a 12-hour webinar. And I think they did it on purpose so long because it gets people excited. It's like one of these 24-hour full-day event. It was nonstop. They had capacity to do 1,000 people. They had a really strong webinar system, and they managed to get there most of the time. It was like the costs were minimal. The platform was free. People spoke for free. They had half hour each. They got 1,000 people remotely participating. You solve all the challenges of participation. So just do it as the consortium. Do it for 24 hours. So it's like time zones, and it's exciting. Do it in different languages and set up really strong architecture. And I think you can do it even like and I think we do not enough just like these cool things, you know, like telethon or something like that. The other thing I want to say that I would really like to see, but I haven't yet seen, I think, is, you know, how there are these exciting things like Waldorf schools, Montessori schools, waking up schools. Now it's really popular in Poland. I wish the term open school could carry that, like, immediate recognition. And then the interesting things, the Montessori movement is not trying to get this whole school system to change. You know, they figured they have their own thing. The only example that always comes to my mind is the American Mountain High Academy. Heights, sorry. And I don't know the details, but I always felt they're really close to, like, getting somewhere there. So I like that example. But I think it can... even more be done in that. Or maybe we'll find out it's just not possible because nobody's surname is open. So, you know, it's like somebody's surname has to be chosen and we'll call it that and it'll work.
I think I will pick up this excellent suggestion about the learners that came out. I think it's a very important point to look at learners, and if one of the things to look at for us, for Cape Town Declaration too, is also focus on educating learners about OER and open education, because that's the lifelong learning toolkit and skill set that we should have with the learners. One of the things we have done is to have, in my organization at Commonwealth of Learning, we have produced a guide for OER for learners. So what they should be doing and using and creating. But important thing is that these tools are more used, just created in one organization and nobody knows about it. It's more to be used. And to use that, teachers are the change agent. And teachers need to first understand it, and then they have to use it. And we have a real problem on that. Not many teachers, we know statistics that Rich talked about the statistics in the US from Babson. Same thing elsewhere. Not many people know about OER. So where do you get a change agent? I'll give you a concrete example of why a school teacher in a remote place in India uses this kind of approach and helps the students to use Facebook video to teach to so many other people. In the process, what is happening, the students are developing competence other than content. They are developing understanding of the content and teaching other people. Not only they are getting other life skills, but also developing competency on the subject. And I see that as somebody who is a change agent who does something like this. And that's the kind of revolutionaries we need in millions probably today. So focus should be on building those capacities of teachers so that they can empower the students as well, or build the capacities of the students to be a lifelong learner using open educational resources, which are available in abundance nowadays. So thank you for bringing on the learner issue.
And maybe this is a good segue into kind of the last round of comments. I mean, if there's more energy, feel free. Maybe we'll do one more, and then, or maybe two more. But also, I think it's okay if we end a couple of minutes early. Is that okay?
Yeah.
Because then I think you've already given your last statement, but I'm going to end by asking the panel what they're excited about kind of for the next 10 years. So we had two hands up, and so I think I'm going to just limit it to those two. Yeah, no one comes down here to us. It's a little...
Hi, I'm Paul Stacey with Creative Commons. I have a provocative comment I'd like to add into the mix around potentially joining forces, Sophie, with others that are working in this space, but also moving beyond thinking about just resources and teaching practices and even policy. If I look at the open space in a larger context, and even if I confine my looking to just education, I might see open access as very much part of the education space and a huge open movement, but it's completely separate. Where's the open access sessions at this conference? I'm saying that there's a really significant movement there that is potentially something that we could join forces with. Similarly, on the open data and analytics side, there's significant activity happening openly around that work that is also related to education and is a significant open movement. So when I look at open education in a kind of macro level, I see a very fractured front of separate open initiatives happening almost completely autonomously, and yet they share a lot of the same values and principles and desires to kind of work in a more open way. And I wonder if there isn't an actual opportunity to kind of unify these currently separate open initiatives into a more consolidated, unified, open approach that could be tackled across the whole school or institution. Anyways, just wondered what you thought about that.
Great idea.
I'm not so sure it's such a good idea. but I told them they weren't allowed to reply, so. Hey, we have someone down here, last hand. Did you have another person, Alec, up there? It's definitely here and here.
Perfect. Jan Neumann from OER World Map Project. Very close, my comment very similar to Paul's comment, actually, thinking about the revolution. And one thought I had that the revolution might come from open research. So as far as I heard, open research sometimes hits the ceiling and often just stays at the bottom. But if maybe it turns out that open research is more effective in solving complex problems like conventional research is doing, I think this would be very supporting for open education as well. So if you start doing open research, collaborative research and at universities, I think it's natural that you start preparing your students doing using open educational resources. So this was just one thing, one comment. And please allow me to introduce all of you to register on the OER World Map. You can link there to the event here as well. And it would be great if you could do so, and it would be very much appreciated. Thanks very much.
Thank you, Alec. Good afternoon. My name is Stavros. I'm from the OEC board and the Brazilian Association of Distance Education. I second the students' perspective, which is fantastic. And then when Paul spoke about the open world, I don't know if you've noticed that education is open, full stop. And we're not even willing in some way to discuss how we're going to interact, not only with the open people, because these guys are sort of our buddies, yeah? But what is happening to the formal educational institutions that are using open as strategy? And we're not even trying to integrate this as a movement inside the movement. So that is maybe a breakthrough more than anything else. Because any institutional that is private or wasn't inside our movement, because we didn't actually, we have to have a mea culpa here. We didn't want to lead this in such a way. We didn't do the marketing properly. Yeah, so we've been doing it for over 40 years, 50 years, or even more time, right? But then all of a sudden, you see people like saying that they've invented MOOCs, and they're going to save the world. And the mistakes they've been committing in getting there has such a high cost in every process. And we're ignoring it, and I guarantee you, the students know exactly where to find it, and we haven't mapped this yet, because there are many organizations that have understood that open is part of a strategy for survival as an institution for the future, and it's not a movement or just a movement anymore. So that's another thing that we have to consider somehow as a very strong variable to what we're doing. Otherwise, we're going to just reinvent wheels all the time and not take advantage of how to leverage this. So that's one.
Great, thank you.
Just put a bit of Greek salt into the problem.
So, Ale, can I get you back on the stage? I think to wrap it up, a quick answer from each of you about we've looked back at the last 10 years. We've started speculating a little bit about the next 10, but for you personally, what is something that you're excited about working on or tackling, looking at the next 10 years of open education, open learning, open? We'll start with Alec. We'll go down, yeah.
Of course, the mic. Open licensing policies. I'm joking only a bit, because I really believe that there are new challenges, but we have to keep on working on the old ones, because things don't change in 5 or 10 years. And I'm very inspired, for instance, for open access movement, which has a longer perspective, and you can see people working 30 years on this very diligently. But then there are new things, and just to be very brief, for me, platforms are a challenge and fascination. I think we could talk for half a day about it. But I just want to mention, I had a very nice talk with Griff from Peer-to-Peer University yesterday about retaining your staff. And just think about YouTube and all these lovely examples, and then look for the download button. And it's like we've all speak about the 5 R's. There are some issues there, and the answers aren't simple. You won't find them in the declaration. We need an addendum.
So 10 years hence. So I think Alec's point earlier about what the declaration was even called was a very interesting, really interesting point. But if you look not at the declaration, but there was an op-ed that went along with it, and that Jimmy Wales and I wrote. And the whole op-ed was not about content, actually. It was about personalization as really the culmination of all of this. And it's funny how long it's taken us to move along that road. But I think that this is a really not only exciting area, but a place where open approaches really could take off. And if you've done anything related to personalized learning, you know that you need not just content, but assessments, lots of assessments, lots of extremely expensive assessments. And even when we talk to the companies who are benefiting from all these billions of dollars of investment in ed tech, they can't develop enough assessments to power their personalized learning system. So I think this is a place where this open education community-generated approach could work. And the reason it could really work here even more effectively than in other areas like textbooks is because you really can write a really high-quality assessment in a couple hours, whereas the commitment to writing a book is a year or years. And so I think we're gonna see, you know, community development curated assessment projects really take off, and we're testing and going to be launching a product called OpenStax Tutor that's integrating into all of our texts that is going to use these kind of assessment development methodology. So I'm really excited about personalization and assessment. Good.
So what I'm excited about is actually educating teachers, governments, lawyers about Creative Commons licensing and OER and libraries and galleries and the whole sort of sector. I've been banging on about this for years. And so what I'm quite excited about is a project that's going to be launched in a few months. It's open now, which is the Creative Commons Certificates, which has been worked on by Paul Stacey and Sarah and a number of others at Creative Commons about sort of developing modular kind of courses and on core CC and copyright for government, for educators, for libraries. Because one of our biggest problems is that there's a lot of people out there who think they know about open licensing and Creative Commons, and they get it wrong a lot of the time. And we have a lot of lawyers who kind of engage in it either, and teachers, and we need to actually start building a experts in particular areas. And so I'm actually very excited about that. I spend a lot of time trying to educate teachers and lawyers and government employees about open licensing, about Creative Commons, about OER. I haven't got enough time to develop these programs, but I'm very keen on actually working with them. So that's what I'm actually super excited about. Oh, sorry. Two?
Yeah. I think I'm not going to talk a lot on anything else because I think for me to see the whole movement and be involved in the process, I see we haven't done enough. There is a lot of unfinished job to be done. And I would say that in the next 5 years or 10 years, let's do more together. Thank you.
That's a hard one to top. I will just say I'm extremely excited about public libraries. Delia mentioned libraries briefly. I think libraries are going to be the infrastructure of education of the future. And then I really appreciated Joran's comment because I got involved in open education and open learning because I thought it was an opportunity to really challenge the way we had organized education with a top-down model where you have to only learn from the expert at the institution, where things are decided for you by other people and you're following the curriculum designed by others, where everything is organized into these silos of disciplines and degrees and the years and the semesters and everything. And that really learning happens in different ways. And I thought open was going to be the kind of the tool to break open some of those antiquated structures. And I feel like we haven't come far enough. So I think my next 10 years is reconnecting with the revolution and finding the revolutionaries inside the institutions and outside. But thank you all for coming, and thank you for the panel. Maybe a round of applause for our four panelists.